We're going to sing some songs together. Are we ready? Yes. It's a beautiful morning out here. And Annie and I, we need your help. We need your help. All right. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Singing and praying with my mind stayed on Jesus. Singing and praying with my mind stayed on Jesus. Singing and praying with my mind stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Can't hate my neighbor. Here we go. Can't hate my neighbor with my mind stayed on Jesus. Can't hate my neighbor with my mind stayed on Jesus. Can't hate my neighbor with my mind stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Makes you love everybody. Here we go. Makes you love everybody with my mind stayed on Jesus. Makes me love everybody with my mind stayed on Jesus. Makes me love everybody with my mind stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Woke up this morning. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, here we go. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. One more time. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Right. So my parents are here visiting for the first time since September. And this morning they said, oh, we're so excited to go to church. My dad said, oh, I can't wait for the music. I can't wait to hear Mark. I said, well, I have news for you. He was very disappointed. So you have us instead. But thanks for helping us out. Thanks for helping us out. The second thing my dad said is that means you're going to make us stand up. Doesn't it? You have to make us stand up. So we are. This song is called Come By Here. So in this song, we're asking God to come by here to be with us during this hour of worship. And there is a part in this song where we will ask you to stand up. In fact, let's practice that, okay? So if you could, if you're comfortable seated and you want to stay seated, that's fine. But, you know, all who would feel like, I'm feeling a little inspired to stand this morning, go ahead. And we'll even say this could be your exercise for the day, right? We'll give you that excuse. So some people stand up, all right? So you put your right fist in the air. Sure, you could do it sitting down too. Right fist in the air, all right? Left knee in the air. And we say, in rain and in storm and in fire and even in wind, God, come by here. We go, ugh, right? So right fist in the air, left knee in the air. Rain, storm, fire, wind, come by here, ugh, all right? So here we go. Rain, storm, fire, wind, come by here. And then the verses go, come by here, clap, clap. Come by here. You got that. It's real easy. Come by here. You got it. All right, let's keep going. Here we go. Come by here. Come by here. Come by here. Come. Now somebody's singing. Somebody's singing, Lord, come by. Let's hear you. Ha, ha. Oh, wait. That's laughing. That's laughing. Singing. Singing is la, la. All right, here we go. Somebody singing, Lord, come by here. La la, somebody singing, Lord, come by here. La la, somebody singing, Lord, come by here. Here we go. Rainstorm, fire, wind, come by here. You can do that rainstorm, fire, wind thing a lot louder. You know, we shouldn't hear the traffic. We should hear you, right? Here we go. Ready? Rainstorm, fire, wind, come by here. Come, there you go. Come by here. Clap, clap. Come by here. Come by here, come by here. Oh Lord, come by here. Come by here. Come by here. Somebody's laughing, Lord, come by here. Ha ha. Somebody's laughing, Lord, come by here. Ha ha. Somebody's laughing, Lord, come by here. Here we go. Rain, storm, fire, wind, come by here. Come by here. Very good. Yeah. Here. Come by here. Come by here. Come by here. Oh Lord, come by here. Come by here. Come by. Now we're all very, very sad. Somebody's crying, Lord, come by here. Somebody's crying, Lord, come by here. Boo-hoo. Somebody's crying, Lord, come by here. Here we go. Rain, storm, fire, wind, come by here. 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 Somebody's praying, Lord, come by here.
Amen.
Somebody's praying, Lord, come by here.
Amen.
Somebody's praying, Lord, come by here. Rain, storm, fire, wind, come by here. 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 Oh Lord, come by here. Come by here. Come by here. Somebody stopping, Lord, come by here.
Woo! You guys crushed it. Right.
All right.
That was good. That was good.
Now this next one, this is our last one for the prelude, we promise.
We promise we have normal songs.
Yeah,
we
do. In the service we have normal songs. This one is not a normal song. So Hadley and Hannah, if you could join us. So if you are a red tent person, all the red tents, let's hear you. Some enthusiasm. All right. If you're a white tent person?
Yeah.
All right. So, this song
is
the red tents are the alleluias. All right? So, when it's your turn you stand, you sing alleluia, 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 alleluia. All right. So, red tents. Here we go. Ready? Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Now you sit down and the white tents sing praise ye the Lord. All right, so let's just do that part. Ready? Red tents, here we go. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Sit down, stand up. Praise ye the Lord. Here we go. Alleluia, alleluia. Red tents, alleluia, alleluia. White tents, praise ye the Lord. Now we switch. Praise ye the Lord. Alleluia.
Praise ye the Lord.
Alleluia.
Praise ye the Lord.
Alleluia. Now together. Praise ye the Lord. All right, let's do that again. Let's do that. We're getting there. We're getting there. All right, here we go. Alleluia, you ready? Oh. Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
Praise ye the Lord.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
Praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord.
Alleluia.
Praise ye the Lord.
Alleluia.
Praise ye the Lord.
Alleluia. Praise ye the Lord. All right, give yourselves a round of applause. All right.
All right, that was great. That was great. What a way to start. I'm on. Are you? Yep, okay. Good morning. God is with us. Here we find new life. Good morning and welcome to First Church of Christ in Simsbury. It is a joy to be together in worship with all of you. This is, I believe, one of the biggest congregations that I have seen since we began outdoor worship. We are aided somewhat by the Gaines family, who is here for the joyful occasion of young Ruth Margaret Gaines' baptism. So we celebrate that this Sunday. But we're more than that. I see some faces out here that I haven't seen in weeks and months and maybe even a year. So praise God. Praise ye the Lord. Alleluia. All of it. Amen. So I don't know if you know what today is. It is certainly baptism Sunday. I have already mentioned that. It is June 12th. It is also Loving Sunday. And I don't know if you have seen that in the news or come across that. It means much more than just loving each other on this day, which I trust we do each and every Sunday. But this is the day that in 1967, the Supreme Court struck down state laws forbidding interracial marriage. So the case had been brought by a woman named Mildred Loving, who with her husband had been arrested. Mildred was of mixed race, her husband was white. They were arrested in the state of Virginia because the couple violated the law in that state that said interracial couples could not marry. So she challenged that. It went all the way up to the Supreme Court, and all those state laws, because Virginia's was not the only one, were struck down. I think that's rather profound, and that it happened in my lifetime. It was 1967. I was 5 years old. And I would just note that any number of couples in our congregation, myself included, could not have been married until, what's going on? Why is that? Okay, let me try that.
Height differences here.
I had a feeling. So Mark Mercier even tested my mic this week and gave it back and assured me, I'm not throwing Mark under the bus, but assured me that it was like all good to go. So I'm not sure what's going on there, but we'll get it right next week. So just to say, what a great day to celebrate our identity as an open and affirming congregation of the United Church of Christ, because part of what that means is that we affirm everybody's identity as a beloved child of God, and we affirm everybody's right to love whom they choose as a beloved child of God, regardless of sexual orientation, regardless of gender, or regardless of race. So happy Loving Sunday to you all. I have just one item of housekeeping, and that is that children will remain with us in worship until immediately following the baptism. And at that point, they will follow their shepherd to church school in the memorial garden. So I think Rev Kev will remind them of that after the baptism, but just parents, so you have a heads up. Let us be together in prayer. Lord of the misfit, whose prophets came like weeds to an ordered garden, shaking all that deadens your love. Give us faith in your kingdom's growth, unruly and exuberant, and let it be shelter wide enough for all, through Jesus Christ our teacher. Amen. Those of you here this morning and those of you watching from home to respond in this call to worship. In all times and in all places, God is with us. Shout for joy. Get ready to become disciples for Jesus. Amen.
So this morning, we are delighted to celebrate the baptism of Ruth Margaret Gaines, daughter of Sarah Gaines. As many of you know, Sarah's grandfather, the Reverend Lyman Potter, was senior minister here at First Church from 1963 to 1986, and he baptized Sarah when she was a baby. Sarah has been a member of First Church her whole life, and has always actively participated in the church's life. And in bringing Ruth forward this morning to be baptized, she shows that she would like the same for her daughter. As we gather for baptism, we like to remember the story from the Gospel of Matthew, where people were bringing children to Jesus in hopes that he might bless those children. The disciples rebuked the people for doing so. They didn't think that Jesus should be wasting his time with children. But when Jesus heard what the disciples were doing, he was indignant, and he said to them, "Let the children come to me. Do not hinder them. To such belongs the realm of God." And Jesus took those children in his arms, and he blessed them.
This gospel story reminds us that the sacrament of baptism is an outward and visible sign of the grace of God for people of every age. Baptism with water and the Holy Spirit is the sign and seal of participation in God's love. The mark of membership in the Church Universal and the beginning of growth into full Christian faith and discipleship. This morning we celebrate that Ruth is God's child, filled with radiant possibility and deeply loved by God.
Sarah, in bringing Ruth to be baptized, do you confess your faith in God as made known to you in and through Jesus Christ? If so, please say, "I do." As her mother, do you promise by God's grace to be Christ's disciple and to witness to the work and words of Jesus Christ as best as you are able? And as Ruth grows in your midst, will you encourage her to do the same? If so, please say, "I do."
I do.
Do you recognize Ruth as God's child, created with her own individual worth? Do you promise to love her as an affirmation of this truth? If so, please say, "I do." When you look at Ruth, will you try to see in her all the children of the world, children of all races and nations? And when holding her, will you remember God's love for all humanity? If so, please say, "I will."
I will.
Do you promise, according to the grace given you, to grow with Ruth in the Christian faith, to be a faithful member of the church by celebrating Christ's presence, resisting oppression and evil, and by making daily life choices that affirm God's love and justice for all, so that one day Ruth may affirm and live out her baptism? If so, please say, "I do, with the help of God."
I do with the help of God.
First, we have some questions for the children of the church. Children, can you stand, please? Will you help to welcome baby Ruth into our church family? If so, please say, "We will." Nice and loud. If so, please say, "We will."
We will.
Will you play with her and share your toys and food with her? If so, children, please say, "We will, with the help of God." Will you teach baby Ruth everything you know about Jesus and help her to learn how to sing and to grow and to pray and to give thanks to God? If so, please say, "We will, with the help of God."
Would the congregation please rise as you are able? Jesus Christ calls us to make disciples of all nations by offering them the gift of grace in baptism. Do you who witness and celebrate this sacrament promise Ruth Margaret Gaines and that her, your love, support, and care as she lives and grows in Christ? If so, please say, "We promise our love, support, and care."
We promise our love, support, and care.
Please be seated.
The meaning of water at baptism is significant. God's Spirit moved over the water at creation. John the Baptist baptized Jesus with water. Water means so many things: birth, death, washing, cleansing, forgiveness, life, and growth. Moreover, water is both ordinary, a part of daily life, and also extraordinary, a wonderful gift that gives life.
So the water that Penny will soon pour into the baptismal bowl is significant to Sarah and to the Gaines family. Ruth's grandmother Meg, Ruth's middle namesake, took water from Jenny Lake in Corinth, New York, where the Gaines family has a cabin and they've had for five generations. So each summer they enjoy time there and swimming in that lake, and Ruth visited for the first time just last week. Let us pray. Blessed by your Holy Spirit, gracious God, this water, that it might symbolize your Spirit washing over Ruth with your love. Glory to you, God of love and life. Amen. Okay. I'm gonna go this way.
Sorry.
Hi. She's right there. She's right there. Yeah. In Psalm 139, the psalmist writes that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, and this tells us that God knows us intimately, and God knows and calls us by name. By what name does God know your child?
Ruth Margaret.
Ruth Margaret. I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. May the Holy Spirit be upon you, child of God, disciple of Christ, member of Christ's church. Magnificent creation of the divine. Amen. We'll now sing our congregational song. So, go ahead and cue that up if you could. Thank you. Let's walk around and visit some people. Do you know these people? Huh? Do you know these people? Huh?
Child of blessing, child of promise, baptized with the Spirit's sign. With this water, God has sealed you unto love and grace divine. Child of love, our love's expression, love's creation, love indeed. Fresh from
Penny, can you hold on? We want to make sure that everybody can hear. So, yep.
Hello. Hopefully you can hear me.
Is it on?
Is it on?
Yeah.
Inside the bag, the gift bag, we have a prayer shawl made by the team at the church that makes prayer shawls for all wonderful occasions. We also have the certificate of baptism and a candle that was created by the children of the church school in remembrance of this wonderful day. And also, we have a
Let us join together in prayer. We give you thanks, O Holy One, Mother and Father of us all, for Ruth and for the grace acknowledged here today in her baptism. Grant us grace to receive, nurture, and befriend her as a new member of your Church Universal. And give to her strength for life's journey, courage in time of suffering, the joy of faith, the freedom of love, and the hope of new life. For Jesus' sake. Amen.
I hear these words from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 4, verses 26 through 34. He also said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow,
he does not know how. The earth produces of itself first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle because the harvest has come. He also said, with what can we compare the kingdom of God, or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of all seeds on the earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade. With many such parables, he spoke the word to them, as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. May God bless these words. Begin with the words that concluded that passage I just read. With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. In Bible study on Wednesday, we talked about what these words might mean, and here are some of the things I learned. Everyone loves a good story. Truth be told, if I were to ask you what you remember most from a sermon that Rev Kev or I preached, you would answer that it was a particular story that we told. But if I then asked you what the point of the sermon was, what it taught you about God or your life of faith, what lesson you learned or how it helped you, well, that might be a little less clear in your memory. This is both the strength and the limitation of stories or parables. They're accessible to everyone, memorable, open to interpretation, and they don't in and of themselves provide an in-depth understanding of Jesus' teaching. Those of you who grew up in Sunday school may remember felt boards. For example, felt cutouts of the ark, Noah, and animals would be stuck up on the board to tell the story of the great flood. The message was super simple. God saved the animals two by two. God is nice. But felt boards with kindergartners don't allow the exploration of hard questions about why this same God killed so many people and so many more animals. Religious teaching spans a spectrum, from children's Sunday school felt boards to seminary graduate school. This is what Mark is saying here, that Jesus did both, told parables that everyone could understand, and went into depth, talked about all the hard stuff with his disciples. I've always figured sermons can function in both ways. Tell some good stories that you will remember, and respect you enough as disciples to dig into the Bible lesson, drawing from the material that any seminary graduate has been taught. So here is one of the essential datum for New Testament studies that among the four Gospels, the Gospel of Mark was written first, and that it was written in or close to the year 70. Why have scholars concluded this? Because Mark contains references to the Jerusalem temple's destruction, which historians know took place in the year 70. For example, verses 1 and 2 of chapter 13 in Mark, as he came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what large stones and what large buildings." Then Jesus asked him, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down." Of course, one could say that Jesus is making a psychic prediction of what the future holds. But most mainstream scholars believe Mark wrote to an audience that had just witnessed the catastrophic physical and symbolic collapse of their world. The teachings of Jesus and the stories he tells in Mark are in response to their world turned upside down. Like I said, that assumption is a starting place for any interpretation of Mark, that it was written around the time that Rome razed the temple. But I have never thought much more about what brought about that catastrophe or the true depth and breadth of Jerusalem's destruction. First, Israel had been occupied by Rome long before Jesus was born. Sometimes it was ruled by Jewish vassal kings beholden to Rome, but allowing a degree of autonomy. Other times it was ruled more directly as a Roman province by procurators that did not respect Jewish law or tradition at all. Throughout this period, Israel was also divided against itself between pro-Roman Jews and those who favored rebellion. Though there were periods of relative calm, most of these years were filled with violence, riots, rebellion, and revolt between Jewish factions and against Rome. This all culminated in a Roman siege on Jerusalem. After a 7-month assault by the Roman army, the walls were finally breached, and the city and the temple were burned to the ground. This happened in the year 70. Hundreds of thousands of Jews were killed, almost 100 were enslaved, and others were forced to be gladiators in the Roman Colosseum. The temple menorah and the table of the bread of God's presence were paraded through the streets of Rome by Emperor Titus. In short, it was bad. Really, really, really bad as it gets. Mark's audience may or may not have been eyewitnesses to the destruction, but Jesus' followers would have felt the apocalyptic implications of the moment. So, what are the first parables that Jesus tells about? Seeds. Like so many parables, these begin, "The kingdom of God is like." The story or metaphor is meant to tell us something about the way things are in God's realm, not just in heaven, but here on earth. So Jesus' followers might have been hoping for a story about a ferocious lion to inspire strength and courage, or a conquering king to instill hope. But what do they get? Seeds. Just seeds. I wouldn't blame Jesus' followers in Mark's community if they responded, "Come on, is that all you got?" I think of the lyric in the Rolling Stones song, "You don't always get what you want, but if you try sometime, you just might find you get what you need." And though we might think we want lions and kings, what we need is the scattered seeds of new life within and among us. This is where kindergarten faith meets seminary faith. I cannot read this passage without thinking about planting a bean in a little Dixie cup filled with potting soil, putting it on a sunny windowsill, watering it, watching it day after day, until with wonder I see the first sprout begin to push up through the dirt. In fact, this is the church school lesson this morning. This is what our kids are doing there right now, is planting their seeds in their little Dixie cups. So So what is it that makes this such an awe-inspiring moment as a kid and, frankly, still as an adult? Maybe the transformation that takes place. We put in a bean and something entirely different emerges. Maybe it is the reach for light, that little bean plant pushing up from the grave, fighting for life. And maybe it is that so little attention is required on our part. Just water, and then check on it every day. That's it. The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself. Notice the parable does not give us instructions about what to do or how to live. It doesn't tell us to scatter seed. The parable tells us that this is how things work in God's neck of the woods. Seed is scattered, time passes, the seed sprouts and grows, there is transformation, life pushes up from darkness to find light, and we just have to stand by and pay attention. Jesus follows this with another parable, this one comparing God's way to a tiny mustard seed that grows into the greatest of all shrubs. I spent quite a bit of time poking around on the internet last night trying to find a picture of the mustard shrub referred to in the parable. And there seems to be some agreement that it refers to the black mustard, the scientific name Brassica nigra. For those in Bible study, this is not the picture I shared on Wednesday of a small tree. The mustard Jesus is referring to is not really a tree at all, but just a massive, dense, tangled mess of stems, leaves, and flowers that reaches at most 6 to 8 feet, but begins just as a single plant, maybe 18 inches tall. The Hebrew Bible, what we call the Old Testament, makes regular reference to majestic cedar trees, not the lowly mustard shrub. Here, too, Jesus' followers might have been excused for thinking, what kind of lousy kingdom is this anyway? But the infinite swirl of God springs forth from the tiniest of seeds, then grows like a weed to provide a safe home for us all. My wife Lourdes and I have tended to overfunction as parents, but our daughter's recent mental health challenges quickly confronted us with the limits of what we can do in response to a crisis, and has required that we trust that God is planting and sprouting new life in our family, pushing us up toward the light, even if we know not how. So again, I remember that awe I experienced as a kid when the bean sprouted in a Dixie cup, the transformation, the emergence into the light, and the fact that so little was required of me, presence, accompaniment, and loving witness are the water that bring forth life from death. And there is nothing we can do to hurry the process. In fact, if in our impatience we try to pull the fragile stem from the seed, we will break it, we will kill it. I came across a quote from one of the prosecutors of Derek Chauvin, the police officer that murdered George Floyd. In his opening argument, Jerry Blackwell referred to the people who stood on the sidewalk and in the street near the scene of Floyd's death as a veritable bouquet of humanity. What words from a lawyer in a high-profile murder trial? I might have thought he would have referred to them as bold, courageous, or heroic, not a bouquet. There's Darnella Frazier, the 17-year-old who filmed everything on her cell phone. That video became central to convicting Chauvin. There's Donald Williams, the young martial arts expert who came upon the scene and called out to the police with advice about how to restrain Floyd without killing him. When he was ignored, Williams called 911 on the police. There's Genevieve Hansen, the off-duty firefighter who tried to help, offering medical assistance. And there's Charles McMillan, the 61-year-old man who was like an unofficial neighborhood watch in the area, who just wanted to know what was going on. Each of these would come to testify at Chauvin's trial. None overfunctioned. Each offered presence, accompaniment, and loving witness. And though they couldn't save George Floyd's life, they did their part, which was enough. Enough to convict Derek Chauvin of murder. They were a veritable bouquet of humanity, each of them a flower sprouted from a small seed that God scattered. On Thursday, Governor Lamont signed legislation that will erase the criminal records of some 300,000 Connecticut residents. This clean slate bill clears misdemeanors after 7 years of no further offenses and some Class C felonies after 10 years of a clean record. Any criminal record represents a kind of death, seriously impacting a person's ability to get a job, credit, or housing. After they have paid their dues for their crime, this legislation provides the opportunity for new life. First Church participated with the Greater Hartford Interfaith Action Alliance, GIA, to advocate for this legislation, and many of our members did their part, attending meetings to strategize, standing on the Capitol steps at press conferences, submitting in-person or written testimony, or calling the governor's office. Not over-functioning, but offering presence, accompaniment, and loving witness. A veritable bouquet of humanity springing up from the seeds God scattered. I just note there is a link on our Facebook page to register for a GIA assembly on Zoom on Tuesday evening. The governor will be present, and a more complete update of GIA's accomplishments this legislative session will be shared, so please check that out. We are a bouquet of humanity. Even in response to the worst catastrophe, whether in our family or in the world, we don't need to overfunction. God has already scattered the seeds that will push up from the dirty underground of our lives to reach for the light and to birth new life. We don't always get what we want, but if we try sometime, we just might find we get what we need, and we need that seed. Amen.
To my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side. I will love you too.
lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path.
And a light unto my path.
Gather together now for our celebrations and concerns as a church, to share them among each other, to lift them to God. We, of course, begin with a celebration of the grace and the love of God expressed in the baptism of Ruth Margaret. We celebrate with all of our graduates. This past Monday was the Simsbury High School graduation, so we celebrate and give praise to God for all the 2021 graduates. Pray prayers of solace and peace for the family of Carolyn Connie Cushman, mother of Rob Cushman, who died peacefully at her home in Proctor, Vermont. Connie passed after a long, full, and meaningful life, just a month shy of celebrating her 94th birthday. We pray for the Fabian family as they travel to Michigan for services for Andy's sister, Angie. We pray strength and comfort for them as they commend Angie's ashes to the ground and her soul to God's safekeeping. Pray for Don Ketchabal, who is in palliative care. Strength and courage for Ted and Sandy Christensen. We pray healing and recovery for all of those who are sick or undergoing treatment, including Lee Ora, as she recovers from mitral valve repair, that her medication may adjust correctly and that she can regain strength. We pray for Kelsey Beach, who spent some time in the hospital and is now home, thankfully, recovering from a kidney infection. We pray for Abby Harris as she continues her participation in an intensive outpatient program. We pray for her healing, for her well-being. We pray for Jim and Rita Bagnall's son-in-law, Douglas, as he undergoes chemotherapy treatment for leukemia. Strength and healing for Carol Pollack as she continues to recover from her back surgery. For Debbie Skinner, who continues to await some serious spinal surgery. For Larry Friel as he continues his recovery from COVID-19. And prayers, as always, of strength and for comfort for Patty Scanlon. Pray for the safety and protection of Thelma Bonners, her nephew, who was recently deployed to the Middle East. His name is Blake Crosby. And for our wider world and community, we pray for all LGBTQ+ people, especially for youth this month as it's Pride Month. And we pray that all youth may find affirmation among parents, family, and friends. And we pray for the safety and protection of all of our elected officials, that they may lead with wisdom and integrity. If you have any prayers that you would like to have added to the list, please see Pastor George. You can see myself or Jessica or Mark. You can also go to the church website, where you can fill out a form on the church website, and your prayer will be submitted to the office. I now invite us to join together in a time of silent prayer. As we collect all of the names and the places on our minds this morning. Gracious and loving God, having shared aloud and praying silently for those we celebrate and for those we weep, we come before you now in prayer. Holy One, in a world in which it is easy to feel as if we are not enough, remind us of the grace and love of baptism. that to each of us you have said, you are my child with whom I am well pleased. In a world in which it is easy to look at others with judgment or scorn, remind us that even those we struggle to like are created in God's image. Open our eyes to see everyone as our brothers and sisters. In a world where we damage your creation daily, help us to be ever more mindful of the beauty of the earth. May we marvel at the wonder of each new day. In a world driven by greed and lust for power, help us not to give up on righteousness and truth, but to stand up for those on the bottom rung of the ladder. In a world where goodness often seems too frail in the face of badness, give us the wisdom and the strength to choose the way of love. In a world where we struggle to understand pain and suffering, most especially in the lives of those we love, we ask for your strength, comfort, and courage. In a world where we can feel so insignificant and helpless, help us to know that you have a place for us. In a world where we so much focus on the future, struggle to be in the present moment, help us to rejoice in each new hour. We pray these things in the name of the one who taught his disciples to pray these words: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So, some announcements. The first thing we're going to do is Bob, our cameraman here, who, by the way, Bob each week brings his own camera and sets this up. Let's give Bob a round of applause. And Bob is going to scan the crowd. He's going to scan. So everybody wave as Bob makes his way. Yeah. Here at Outdoor Worship, there is water. There is lemonade for after the service. So please, or even during the service, if you get thirsty, so we can congregate there after. Of course, we're continuing to offer both outdoor and virtual worship. So whichever way works for you, for your family, we're just glad to have you. If you are planning to come to outdoor worship, you can park down by Boy Scout Hall, walk up by the front of the church. That's probably the surest way to get here. Sometimes there are some spots up near the house at 6 West. But if you need a ride, you can flag down the golf cart, and Greg Calkin, our golf cart driver, will be glad to bring you up. As always, if you could, do your best to bring your own chairs. If you forget a chair or you don't have one to bring, that's fine. We have some here, but it would help us out a lot if a lot of people could bring the chairs. Church school each week in the Memorial Garden. Tonight, there is a youth summer mission trip meeting. It is tonight at the high school, behind the high school. For all those going on the trip, it's important to attend. Our Iron Horse Walking Group meets at 9 a.m. on Tuesday mornings. I think I've been saying 10 a.m. My understanding is that group meets at 9 a.m. on Tuesday mornings in the parking lot behind Fitzgerald's. And Pastor George's Bible study is on Wednesday mornings at 10 o'clock on Zoom. Each week we invite an offering, and each week you can leave your gifts in the baskets on the way out, or as always, donate at any point online. May the gifts and the offerings brought this day be used as seeds planted faithfully and nurtured lovingly, so that God's way may be realized anew in this world. Amen.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home. God's celestial shore, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away
in the morning
when I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have gone, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison doors has flown, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away
in the morning.
When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away. To a land where joy shall never end, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away.
In the morning,
when I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. I'll fly away.
So I'm not sure it was said, but Mark Mercier, the reason he's not here this morning is because he's off this weekend playing rock and roll, as he is wont to do. So we bless him in that as well. We are especially grateful that Rev Kev and Annie Petiti stepped up. And I know I sort of kind of started some applause, but can we again like thank them for It does provide a certain energy when Kevin leads us in some of those camp songs. So I just love it. I just love it. I would also note that our soundboard person, Elliot Parmalee-Witt, is away. Our building superintendent, Ardell, is off. And I would just like to affirm the whole team for not missing a beat. You know, my mic again gave a little bit of problem, but you know, again, we just keep pressing on. I would also say one other thing before I pray us out, and that is every minister is taught not to get hung up on numbers. Whether we're speaking or preaching to two people or 2,000, we bring the same energy and spirit, but I can't help it. I did a quick head count. I think there are about 60 folks here this morning. I looked, there were about 40 signed on to our Facebook. Those 40 usually represent multiple people, so I bet we're up around 120, which is a very that's a great number, and it's very exciting that coming out of this COVID period that we have such energy and enthusiasm in the church. So I thank you for that, whether you're at home or whether you're here in person this morning. Now may the Spirit of the living God, made known most fully to us in Jesus Christ, go before you to show you the way, go above you to watch over you, go behind you to nudge you into places you might not go by yourselves. Go beneath you to uphold and uplift you. Go beside you to be your strong and constant companion. And dwell within you, that you may know that you are never, ever alone, and that you are loved, loved beyond your wildest imagination. And may the fire of God's blessing burn brightly upon you and within you today and always. Amen.
Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace. Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace.